And we're on. Okay, thanks for your patience. Multiple cables, we found the right one. I'd like to share with you about shared solar, prepaid electricity through mobile telephony. There's a lot of us working on the project under Vijay Modi, as you can see. My name is Matt Basinger, and I'll walk you through the what shared solar is. So again, prepaid electricity through mobile telephony. Let's take that apart. Electricity first. 2 billion people in the world live without access to the electric grid. What do they use for energy? What do they use for lighting? Kerosene lanterns, very common. This is a picture from Mali a few months ago. This is a picture also from Mali of what fuels those lanterns. This is a baggie bought for about 50 cents at the corner kiosk that a household would go through each night. It's a horrible irony that in the context of the developing world, sub-Saharan Africa, where we're deploying shared solar, the lowest quality energy is going for the highest rates. People are paying the most for the worst quality energy. This is a kerosene lantern in a household. These aren't beer cans by the side of the road. These are batteries. But D-cell batteries, again, speak to this idea of a very low amount of energy that people are using, discarding, becoming environmental issues for a high price. Maybe you're only paying 50 cents or a dollar for a pair of dry cell batteries, but the amount of energy that you're getting out is huge when you look at the electric grid and what that can provide. It's more than just lanterns that people are using. Cell phones have been a huge leapfrog technology, I'm sure you're all aware of, throughout the developing world, just really taken off the last decade. So people have cell phones that are living on a few dollars a day, and they're charging them for 25 cents a pop. Again, for a tiny fraction of energy is going into that 25 cents, and it's being charged, here you see, by a generator, sometimes by an inverter and a battery. These are all pictures from Mali, Uganda, different countries we're working in sub-Saharan Africa. So you have a car battery, okay, that in that last picture you saw an entrepreneur who is charging to charging people to charge batteries, charging money for that battery charge. They would then maybe haul that battery to a town that is connected to the grid with a battery charger in and charge these 12-volt car batteries. Again, very expensive. People go to great lengths for energy in these contexts, carrying generators for pumping water, for electricity. Though there is quite a bit of ingenuity, here we see a donkey cart with an engine and an agro-processing system, a miller, attached to it. What does all this point toward? On the y-axis, you have the unit cost of energy, dollars per kilowatt hour. On the x-axis, the purchase cost. So this is the entry-level cost. If you want this type of energy, this type of electricity, this is the minimum you're going to have to pay for that purchase. The more you're able to pay, the cheaper the electricity. So, you know, at a very low cost to purchase are D cells, those beer can-like looking dry cells you saw by the side of the road. But when you look at the amount of energy, it's very, very low. Cell phone charging, a little bit better. Car battery charging, a little bit better yet, but we're still talking dollars or tens of dollars per kilowatt hour. There's a jump when you look at traditional microgrids, when you look at the connection fee, the monthly charge that someone has to pay for using a microgrid. We're still talking in the tens of dollars or several dollars per month, but a little bit better energy price. And the grid, of course, being the gold standard. Shared solar tries to bridge this gap that's in the middle. That's the electricity story. So what about the prepaid and the mobile telephony? I mentioned earlier, cell phones have been a huge leapfrog technology. Look back at India 10, 15 years ago. In the US, you pay for your cell phone monthly with a subscription. At the end of the month, you post-pay maybe $50. In India, they looked at doing a similar thing, $5 a month post-pay. It didn't take off. You know, cell phone subscriptions increased, but very, very marginally. At the point where they saw that these variable incomes that often subsistence farmers have could be accessed via prepaid scratch cards, the last decade you see this huge increase in cell phone subscriptions globally. Most of this growth is in the developing world. And it's because of the prepayment. So again, in India, though, they were charging $5 post-pay. When they disaggregated that and allowed people to buy scratch cards, 50-cent scratch cards, $1 scratch cards, 20-cent scratch cards, the average ended up being about $5 paid per month, just in a prepayment fashion. That's what Shared Solar is looking to leverage, is that model, the mobile infrastructure that's just taken off throughout the developing world. A traditional grid, what does it look like? A traditional grid brings in power lines, you know, at huge connection fees, thousands or thousands of dollars per connection into a community. The community's connected and now has electricity, but at this high, high rate, a very high quality service though. Shared Solar looks at providing a distributed power approach. So the idea is to go into this community where there's 10, 20 households within a 50 to 100 meter radius, put in a power generation system, a solar panel, some batteries, a charge controller, and a smart meter. Now this smart meter is what we've been developing in our lab and deploying in the Millennium Villages. This smart meter talks to a remote gateway that is this utility that has a server there on the bottom right-hand corner you see in the blue. This server has all of this prepayment accounting and infrastructure that takes care of these transactions, these scratch card transactions. So you have someone with a cell phone in one of these homes. They send a text message to top off their airtime for the month. It goes to the gateway, to the meter, and lights are on. And now they have this much credit. Once it's down, they have to buy another scratch card. One community, though, is a network for an entire micro-utility. So this is one of our payment gateway servers can support tens or hundreds of communities and shared solar systems. Again, cutting down on the operations cost because of the remote monitoring capability. So where are we at? About 10 months ago, we started using off-the-shelf components, developing software to run those off-the-shelf components and deploy them in the Millennium Villages. We've been working with collaborators at Berkeley to develop custom hardware to drive down the cost of that power metering circuitry, bring down the power consumption as well. And across both platforms, we've built in-house software, both the payment gateway side and the actual metering service that works across different hardware platforms. Where is this being deployed? Where are we at from an actual deployment standpoint? We're deploying this currently in 3 countries, 24 systems in Mali, Uganda, and Tanzania. I got back on Saturday from Uganda where we just commissioned a system here. 7% electricity penetration in Uganda. Huge opportunity, huge need for high quality energy. Here, this is an aerial photograph you saw in Vijay and Matt's earlier talk. A lot of the remote sensing and geospatial analysis they're doing that we're using here when we go in and design our systems. So looking at a community, we find an optimal place where we can then run these transmission lines, which are the yellow lines, to the purple, which are the houses. Similarly, this is a system in Mali. It's interesting, the actual settlement patterns from one country, from one location, from one culture to another, where in Uganda, people are settling in homestead environments, so we're targeting trading centers, like the last slide you saw, or here, where there's much more concentrated populations living in villages in Mali, so the transmission lines are shorter. What does the system look like when it's done? There's a shed with some panels on top, maybe 1-2 kilowatts of panels, a few hundred amp hours of batteries, charge controller, and the smart meter inside. We do the wiring for the, or we partner with local contractors to do the wiring in the houses. The scratch cards, again, are this enabling piece that allows the prepayment. Here are pictures of these credit card-sized scratch cards that are used for these transactions. This is a picture from 3 days ago. Our system in Uganda that was being commissioned here, one of the Millennium Village staff is training some of the consumers on how to send the text messages that turn on and off their lights, charge up the electricity time on their accounts. You know, it's a familiar process because they're already doing this with their cell phones. This is a great picture. It's a little light in here, so you can't quite make it out. You'll have to go to our website to see it. But on the right, this is that grid in Uganda 2 days ago. This is the shared solar system providing light on the right. Here on the left, you could see a red dot, a kerosene lantern. Huge difference. What does this allow? Light at night allows a gentleman here to continue working on a sewing machine. A child that previously worked on the left, this is a picture from Mali now, or Mali installment, from a kerosene lantern light, is able to do homework by a much better quality light source. How much are people consuming? We're talking tens of watt hours per day. This is could be as little as a hundredth of what a household is consuming in the States. These are very small amounts of energy. So you can see, and it also comes at night, is the primary time in which people are consuming energy. This is averaged over our Mali site last month over the consumers there. How often are people purchasing? Do people go for days or weeks without topping off their account, without adding, you know, buying scratch cards? Here on the x-axis is the month of March, the days of March, and on the y-axis is SEFA, which is the Mali currency. It's about 1,000 SEFA to $2. So you can see people are buying in increments of $1, $2 every couple days, maybe once a week, on average spending about, you know, $5 to $7 per month. So that's the background on what shared solar is. What I'd like to do now is show you a demo. We brought some of our meters, and I'm going to show you how you can turn on and off lights, monitor things remotely. So let me switch over here to that system. Okay, the first thing, this is a picture of our payment gateway. Here you see this is real-time information we're getting from a remote village in Mali. You can see earlier today someone topped off credit. This is the website that handles all these transactions, and this is basically real-time information from earlier today. So now what I'd like to show you is we're going to connect to one of our meters, and we're going to see how the real-time metering happens and some of this accounting that enables the use of these scratch cards. So here what I have is, you got it?
Yeah.
Okay, great. So Justin's going to help me. He's been doing a lot of the enclosure design and hardware development for us. There's two boxes here you see at the base of the stage. One box is the control box. This has the mobile phone modem that allows the communication from the meter to the gateway. The other enclosure has all the metering circuitry. So one by one, you'll see as Justin plugs in the circuits, now we have circuit number one. This is simulating a household. This is a highly efficient LED light, just a few watts. The next circuit that he turns on is this red LED. That's about 20 watts. This fourth circuit, this is a very power-hungry incandescent light bulb, 200 watts, and you can see it's going to start really eating up this credit. We've preloaded each of these circuits with about one penny of, or five SEFA worth of credit. On circuit five, we have a cell phone. That's another really common use. So what you're seeing in these bar charts, this is real-time communication with the meter, the accounting that's going on, and what happens is, again, a consumer loads up credit with their cell phone to the meter, and they get that much energy credit, and then the relay switches off, and they need another scratch card. So we're going to watch circuit four as it counts down. Here we go. Wait for it. And the lights go off. So the relay tripped, the meter detected that it was at zero credit, and now I need to charge up. So I'm going to send a text message with my cell phone, and I'm going to add credit and turn it back on. So hopefully I have cell phone reception in this room. So I've sent a message with a scratch card. Again, this is a little scratch card code, and we'll see credit bounce back up. At the same time, I'm going to turn the circuit on. So, assuming that the mobile network is strong enough in here, we will anticipate the, again, what's happening is my cell phone is sending a message with a code. There it is. It goes to T-Mobile. T-Mobile sends it to our remote gateway, our payment gateway. The payment gateway sends a message to our meter. Credit is charged up, and in a moment here, it'll pass the message to turn the circuit on as well. Let me send that message out. There we go. So now, what else can this do? This is also for, I'm going to change to a page where you can see energy being displayed. Here again, we have the four circuits. We can do load balancing. This is important because in a PV system, you have batteries. People are using this at night. We want to allocate people a certain amount of energy, a quota of energy, a certain number of watt hours per day. So what we've done is we've set, for the purposes of this presentation, just 6 watt hours as a threshold. This is what we'd call Emax in our software algorithm. After, you know, what'll be about another minute, this light bulb will hit its Emax, and the lights will go out again. Again, this is so that someone can't plug in an electric iron, someone can't run, you know, a huge appliance that then will eat up all of the available energy for everyone else. And the light goes out. Now someone tomorrow can charge, start up their circuit again and have a fresh batch once the sun comes out and provide some more energy to the system. So this is shared solar. This is our system, and I'd like to thank you very much.